coming to the stage from Hartsdale, Alabama, Brent Crow. Wow! Take it front and center, a five-best limit on Championship Saturday. $245,000 richer.
Well, here we are, bright and early. Pickwick Lake, the Toyota Series Championship just wrapped up. We got the champ, Brent Crow. Dude, phenomenal final day. 23 pounds of smallmouth in like 45 minutes. Couldn't ask for a better ending.
No, I mean, it was crazy. I hoped that it would be like that. I thought it might be, and then it turned out it was, but it was nerve-wracking. You saw me losing several, and until I got that fifth big one in the boat, it was pretty nerve-wracking, but it was an unbelievable hour for maybe a little more than an hour of fishing. I mean, I told somebody last night, it's probably the most chaotic hour I've ever had fishing.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. It was quite the yard sale for a little while. But you have a ton of experience on Pickwick. I'm hoping we can just scratch the surface a little today, learn a little bit about fishing a tail race, maybe learn a little bit about catching a spotted bass, depending on how things go. But we're not going to catch them up here on the ramp. We got to launch this Phoenix. We got to get out there. They're pulling water now. They're probably not biting, but let's go see if we can get one.
We'll see. Maybe we can scrounge out a few today before they turn the water up too high.
Yes. Okay, Brent, we are back here below the Wilson Dam at the scene of the crime from yesterday where you absolutely smashed smallmouths, but totally different story today, so totally different series of baits we're gonna throw.
Right, running a little too much water today than they were yesterday, so our top water would be at the bridge, you know, in no time. So we're throwing a swim bait, half ounce jig head with a 5-inch Berkeley hollow belly swim bait.
And you really said yesterday the conditions were perfect for what you did. It didn't work out the first couple days. Heck, it hasn't worked for a couple years, you said. It was just the timing of it, right amount of flow for that wake bait to work.
Yeah, it was amazing because I was mad all week because we had too much current. I mean, I got in this tournament, or I tried to qualify because I had a little secret, and I'm like, I ain't even gonna be able to do it, you know. And then for whatever reason, yesterday I got up here and they were running 35,000 cubic feet per second, and I'm like, wow, this may happen, and it did for an hour. And then, you know, today we're out here and it's 51,000, and if I would have gotten here yesterday and it was like this, then I wouldn't be here on day five.
Right. So it perfect time for things to line up, but we're gonna bomb these swim baits around. We're still gonna try to catch us a couple of bass fishing in the tail race, and maybe at least try to, you know, teach the people a thing or two about throwing a swim bait in some current.
Right. And, you know, and on normal falls, 50,000 for a swim bait's perfect. So it just hadn't worked the first 2 days of the tournament or in practice, but maybe yesterday was the turning point.
Hey, man, if they start eating a swim bait, I'm not gonna, you know, argue with that. And I'm also gonna start casting so I can, this is like the only opportunity I'm gonna have to actually outfish you, I think,
today. They start biting, we may have a day six.
Brent, you know, the interesting thing is, we were talking about at the ramp, I mean, a swim bait and a tail race is no shocker.
Right.
But the thing that I find a little interesting is just how you fish it in terms of slip drifting, and you're not casting up into the current or you're not casting down with the current.
Right.
We're perpendicular.
Right.
Right?
Yeah, and I mean, we're in about 8 or 10 feet of water. I mean, there's, you know, there's contours and rock piles and ridges and stuff, but when I'm drifting, I want the bait, I'll make a cast straight at the bank, perpendicular to the boat, and as the boat moves, your bait moves. Your bait's always right there. You've always got it working properly. If you throw upstream and then, you know, the boat's moving, then your bait wants to rise.
Yep.
You throw downstream, it's the same, you know, it's just, it doesn't work. And I see a lot of people do that. They pull up, throw straight upstream. And also, you know, I guide all the time. And the one thing about guiding is you don't want to stay hung all the time. And by doing it this way, you don't get hung. And like I said, you've got your bait in the strike zone from where you cast almost all the way to the boat. And you want to slow roll it. You're not trying to hit bottom. You want to keep it down. You don't want to burn it. I mean, fish feed up. You know, their eyes are on top of their head. So,
yep.
But at the same time, you know, you don't want it up right up under the surface. So you just want to slow roll it. I use a 6-4-1 reel. I've got 15-pound trailing, 100% fluorocarbon, half-ounce weight, fusion jig head. And most of the time it's a 4 or 5 inch swim bait, but you know, I think that it's the most efficient way to do it, and it's also the best way. I mean, I've never seen anybody that all the people that I know that do it, they all do the same way. I mean, all the local hammers and all, yep, and the people, yep, that I've learned from, and we swap ideas and whatever, but everybody drifts, throws perpendicular. Uh-oh.
It's bum rushing me. I don't know what it is.
Oh,
oh. It's a smallmouth, but like
miniature. Well, he's
not bad.
Not bad.
I mean, eat. Not the size. Well, you did catch a few like this yesterday, but not. Look at that. That is a Pickwick smallmouth. Boom. Swim bait current with the man himself crushing it. Load it up. Good one?
I don't know where he's running at.
Charging you.
I think he's decent. But
I'll take decent.
Oh.
Hey now. Come on in here.
Whoops.
Come on back in here.
Think he didn't want the swim bait? You couldn't even see
it. I mean, it choked it.
Yeah, he wasn't coming off.
No. You were talking about it yesterday, but man, these things, regardless of size, in this current, when you get a smallmouth fighting.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, yesterday, there were some times, even with, you know, I mean, you caught a lot of 4-pounders, but there were times where you were just along for the ride, basically. Okay, Brent, while, you know, you caught some fish on a shaky head, days 1 and 2, this guy right here, the wake bait, is really the star of the show. So give me a little rundown, you know, how you fished it, the setup you threw it on, and maybe a little bit, like, why a wake bait?
Well, you know, about, I don't know, 15, 20 years ago, I think it was a tournament at Beaver Lake that was won on a wake bait. And it was when I just started fishing, you know, pro tournaments or whatever, and I didn't know anything about it. And luckily, I had a couple of friends from East Tennessee where it all started, and they filled me in. I remember I was at Smith Lake one day, we were practicing for a tournament. Wesley Strader happened to be on one of my best nighttime holes. I just pulled over there to talk. I said, "You're on a good hole at night." And then I said, "Hey, tell me about this wake bait." And he digs in his tackle box and got one out, and he's like, "Here's your tie loop knot, and this is what you do." And I'm like, "Really?" And while he's doing that, he throws it and catches one. And I'm like, "Huh." And so ever since then, I've thrown it at Smith, and I've thrown it all over the Tennessee River. And it's just, I don't know, some days, you know, around here, we get a lot of fishing pressure. And I think that the subtleness of it helps them more than a spook. I mean, you know, to me, I mean, you watch it across the top. It's just like the menace just, you know, oh, I'm just easing along, no threat here. And I mean, it just looks like something a fish would eat. And they do, thank goodness.
Oh, yeah.
But I think it's, you know, a great bait for places where the fish are really pressured. Obviously need clear water, but I mean, you know, it's not that clear here.
Right.
But I mean, it's become one of my favorite baits.
And yesterday, it just fit the situation. You had the right amount of water, you know, only a few feet deep, so that this can actually call them up to it.
Right.
As opposed to trying to call them out of 8-9 feet of water,
right.
in that situation at the tail race.
Yeah, if it's gonna be, you know, it'd have to be real clear. Smith Lake, they'll come from 10 or 15
sure.
feet to hit it, but here, you know, they're not gonna come from 10 or 15 feet and hit a topwater. But it's just been, you know, something that I've done for ever since that day, basically, that Wesley showed me how to do it. And I've become a collector. I mean, you know, there are old ones and new ones and whatever. I hoard them now, the old ones especially, but you know, the new ones work just as good too. And you know, I've tried, like everybody else, I've tried all kinds of wake baits and you know, it's a fun way to fish, and it's easy for guiding too. It's really easy because, I mean, throw it out there and reel it in.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot to it, really.
Right. I mean, but it's, you know, there is and there isn't. I mean, yes, you have to reel it in, but you have to do it a certain way. I mean, you know, it's a wake bait. So, but this, you know, this bait in particular is not a wake bait. It's a jerk bait. And like I always tell people, it's a terrible jerk bait. Like if you want to throw a jerk bait, don't throw this one. But for a wake bait, it's the best. And yeah, I think, you know, the reason, I mean, the wiggle on it is, I guess, I mean, like I said earlier, you know, I've never talked to a fish, but the wiggle on it seems to be the deal. But the key to it is to keep it on top. And so you throw it in, I fish it on 15-pound mono, and you point your rod up where you have the bow in your line, and then you just reel slow. And if you reel it too fast, it goes underwater. If you reel it too slow, it don't wiggle. So there's a fine, you know, there's a fine line, and what you want is the V behind it, where it's a little bit of a ripple today, but you see it makes a V wake. And I mean, that's all there is to it. Once you get that going, nothing else to it. But you know, you can throw it. I have people that throw it on spinning rod. You can put it on braid with a leader or bait caster, either way. I mean, it's a really versatile bait and easy to use. And I mean, it catches fish, no doubt about it. I mean, you know, there are times where a spook would be, or a walking bait would be better, but there's also times where this is far and away the better bait. And yesterday was one of them.
Brent, I've had an absolute blast hanging out with you on Pickwick today. I appreciate you showing us around. It was, you know, the week, we've said it a bunch, you know, I wrote about it, the fact that everything came together for you to win here on basically your home pond. You know, things were right. They may not be right again for a while, but you at least got the trophy. You got $247,000 for 3 days of work. Not a bad payday. And, you know, you got a nice little trophy for the mantle.
That's right. I mean, yeah, I thought about it last night. I mean, there's only two tournaments in the world that pay more than this. And so there's only like, what, 50 people has ever won this much in a bass tournament. So it's pretty remarkable. And you know, aside from the amount of money, I mean, just the prestige and the bragging rights that I got with some of my buddies now that fish, you know. So, I mean, it was an awesome, awesome week. And that hour yesterday, I'll never forget.
Well, I think with that, we can go load this thing back up, let you get to the house, relax a little bit. But I appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Congrats again, man.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
One more cast.